Hello and welcome again to ITU Telecom World here in Geneva, Switzerland, where I'm talking to Deborah Taylor-Tate, who is a special envoy to the ITU, and she's in charge of the COP initiative, Child Online Protection. Deborah, you're very welcome. What is the key message that you've been delivering at the ITU show?
Well, first of all, as you know, telecom has been so involved in trying to deploy broadband to the world and to the last village and the last mile in very rural parts of our whole globe. While at the same time that there are these incredible opportunities for solving problems, there are also some challenges that more and more of us face online. Cybersecurity, of course, our financial security, and increasingly our children are facing some pretty tough issues online. So those range all the way from cybersecurity, spending too much time in front of screens. We see kids spending up to 10 hours a day, more than in any other activity in the United States online, which of course adds to our obesity problem, not just in the U.S., but around the world increasingly. And then there are more serious mental health and emotional disorders that we're beginning to see as well. So I guess one message is just that we all need to be cognizant about children going online at a younger and younger age and some of the potential pitfalls that they face there.
So, what are the greatest dangers that children face online?
Well, I don't think that you can say there's any one danger because, of course, children are as different, you know, as we all are, as countries are, as nations are. And so I think that what we have to do is look at how children are using technology. And so in so many ways, it's been incredible. Here at World Telecom, we've had the young innovators, and we've seen these brilliant ideas that these young teens have come up with, and people in their young 20s that both save lives, are good for the planet, save energy. So it's so exciting to see them working in this space and actually innovating, coming up with things that we haven't come up with yet, which is really fantastic. But more and more, in fact, this week a study was released in the States that goes all the way to age zero. So it's from 0 to 8 years old and how much kids are using the technology, how much time they're spending, and how it's affecting them. Interestingly, I don't know if you've seen this, but you know, you watch parents hand a one-year-old a smartphone and all they have to be able to do is this to be able to open it up. So we've gone beyond the early issues of just child exploitation and child predatory behavior into many, many more kind of emotional issues. And in fact, to me, this has really become a global health issue. And so I think that we have to move it out of just the telecom space into all of the other sectors of our society so that we are also all aware of what's going on online and we're all part of the solution.
So are parents alone responsible for limiting children's access to online content, or do you think the government and other agencies as well should have a role to play?
Well, the short answer is no, parents aren't just responsible, although obviously they are the first line of defense for kids. What we often say is we just need a little common sense and that people need to be the parent. And so they need to set guidelines, just like you do for your children in the real world. And I think the other point is that parents need to quit thinking that there's a virtual world and a real world, because our kids now live in this online space. So it's no longer virtual, it's the very real world to them. And yes, I think government does have a place in this space. And like any other problem, government needs to provide leadership and vision. Sometimes government is the convener, not necessarily that it takes regulatory action, but that they can convene the right people. And that's why the ITU is such an important player, that they are able to bring the ministers together along with the private sector, the NGOs, you know, and then also that they have a platform to then begin speaking to the world about these issues.
So Deborah, Is there yet any agreement on precisely what constitutes child exploitation? Has it been codified yet?
Well, interestingly, I was able to speak to the International Parliamentarians Union here in Geneva a few months ago. And many of the countries, as you can imagine, have no laws about crimes in the online space. And so many countries, many nations are starting at the very beginning. And it's very interesting because child exploitation and child pornography are some of the key issues that nations can agree on. So, as you know, the Secretary General has created the Child Online Protection Initiative within the ITU. And one of his major points is that for a long time in the cybersecurity space, he was talking to engineers and ministers and that no one could agree. But as soon as he brought up children and the protection of children, everyone could get around the table. So to your point, yes, we are beginning to make all those changes. In many of the more developed nations, many of those definitions have already been ironed out and are actually in law. One of the one of our hopes for the Child Online Protection, the COP initiative, is that we'll be able to provide that expertise so that if you're a parliamentarian in another nation, you can actually pull a toolkit off the bookshelf that will say, here's model legislation, here are some examples of model definitions, here are speeches, here are articles, here's research. You know, let us help you in your nation.
There are many aspects to child exploitation, of course, as far as technology is concerned, but one of the big issues in the United Kingdom at the moment, and I know it's the same in the United States, is cyberbullying. We've had suicides in our country as a result of this, and this is just one aspect of what's going on. How about the children themselves? How can they be involved to help protect themselves?
Absolutely. I think this kind of goes back to from the moment that a child gets online, using common sense ways to teach your child about civil behavior. So just like in the real world, we don't allow kids to beat each other up on the playground, and we go out and we separate them and we talk to them, right? That's the same thing that we need to be doing online, and we need to be having those conversations really earlier and earlier. So if toddlers are using smartphones, we need to be talking to the toddler, you know, about being nice online. When you talk to your little friend Janie, be nice to Janie. Say nice things about Janie. You know, since I've been here at World Telecom, this is so sad. I've gotten two emails from people who just found my email and wrote me and said, my child has been cyberbullied. Do I need a lawyer? Do I need a psychiatrist? And it's heartbreaking because you're right. Many times this goes unreported. In fact, in America, only 1 in 10 kids even report that they've been cyberbullied. So the problem is also much larger than it's even being reported. Many, many kids just are fearful about reporting it. So one of the things that we also need to do is empower our children, to your point, so that they are able to take care of themselves online.
And where does cybersecurity fit into all this?
I think that one of the brightest parts about child online protection and specifically the ITU's initiative is that it really does provide us a starting place for the entire larger umbrella of cybersecurity. So just like we talk about financial security in a much larger sense with banking institutions and financial entities, we need to teach our children from the very beginning. Don't give out your private personal information. Queen Sylvia often says that criminals go after the weakest link, and that's exactly what is happening online as well.
What is the end aim of the COP initiative?
Well, I wish I could say it would be finished, but of course there will always be another technology. Now we are not just looking at child predators and child exploitation and financial issues. Now we're looking at privacy issues and behavioral advertising, click to buy, for instance. So suddenly an 8-year-old is clicking through a phone and purchasing all kinds of, things that they want online. How much should you advertise to young minds? Because we recognize that children under 8 don't even understand the concept of persuasion. They take everything as the truth. You need to buy this doll. You need to buy this game. And so, in a way, our job will never be done, which is good because there will always be a new technology or a new innovation. But I think that what we will begin to see is that more and more youth will be empowered, that much of the work that we're doing now about curriculum actually getting into substantive school subjects, so that a teacher isn't just teaching science, but they're teaching kids how to use a flip cam, and they're saying, if someone you're interviewing starts asking very personal questions, you should stop that interview. And so I think that we're going to begin to see more savvy teachers and more savvy students and users and youth, and that's, of course, what we want.
Now, COP hasn't got a definitive ending, but it does have phases. What's the next one?
The next phase is really looking for the leadership at a national level. Hamadoun Touré has been an incredible visionary leader at the international level. He has now elicited a call to action where he hopes that national leaders will respond. So we have been to China during the World Expo. We went to Japan. But we now have a new patron, and that is President Laura Chinchilla of Costa Rica. And the next step in the next phase for COP will actually be very structured in that we will have curriculum for schools, we will have strategies for multiple stakeholders, we will have model legislation that parliaments can use, and we will have, hopefully, regional and global events where people such as a patron, for instance, will host the ITU to discuss COP and how we can continue to expand.
Deborah, can you tell us one thing that you think needs to happen if we're ever going to get any closer at all to concluding the mission of giving more global citizens more meaningful access to connected technologies?
The youth. Involving our youth in new and innovative designs and ideas and technologies and just how to reach young people all over the world.
Deborah Taylor-Tate, thanks very much indeed. Thought-provoking stuff.